Is now the right time to start hiring inside salespeople? And why would you even consider doing it? We're going to dig into this and a whole lot more today as we talk about how to grow your business with an inside sales team. We have a special guest. You do not want to miss this. Hi, I am Tim Fitzpatrick with Rialto Marketing, where we believe marketing shouldn't be difficult. All you need is the right plan. Thank you for tuning in. Really appreciate it. I am super excited to have with me today Matt Milia from Appointments Today. Matt, welcome and thanks for taking the time.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, Tim.
You bet, man. It's hard to believe that next week is Thanksgiving.
It's crazy. It's gone by so fast.
It does go by fast. It's crazy how time flies when you're in a pandemic. So before we get into this, just fun fact, what's your favorite part of Thanksgiving dinner?
That's a great question. I would say stuffing because my grandma makes stuffing and then so does my aunt. And they usually compare the two. And my aunt puts bacon in one. My grandma has an old school Italian recipe. So, I mean, the stuffing.
You're a stuffing man. I am a stuffing man as well. So I grew up, my dad grew up in Cape Cod in Massachusetts. They had this old meat stuffing recipe that was so good. Loved it. And then my wife, her mom is Australian. They have a bread stuffing recipe that is so good. And growing up, I didn't have bread stuffing. I always had meat. And so it's, you know, there's bread, there's apples, you know, there's prunes in there, onions. What else is in there? There's bacon. Oh my God, it's so good. So
can't go wrong with bacon.
No. Bacon makes everything better, right?
That's right.
Before we start talking about how to grow your business with an inside sales team, tell us a little bit more about you, what you're doing at Appointments Today.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, like Tim said, my name is Matt Milia. We actually started, it's kind of funny because we started Appointments Today totally by accident. We were running our own real estate team in Cleveland, Ohio. And my partner at the time, his name is Al. Al and I were really struggling to get to that next level. We were really capped. We couldn't do any more deals. Our agents were running crazy. So much stuff was going on. And what we found was that we needed some help. So we started looking around online. We hired an inside sales company. They were in the Philippines. And at the time we said, you know what, let's give it a shot. We went through 27 people to find two good ones. And after that, I was like, there's got to be a better way. So we said, you know what, we're going to start our own. And that's really kind of how we got started. We were a part of a bigger community. Real estate's all about community.
Yeah.
And we had a big coaching group we are part of. And in that coaching group, the number one challenge that agents would say, well, I have all these leads, but I don't have someone to call them. Or I have all these leads, but I don't know what to say when I call them. So that was really us filling that need. And we've been going now for 6 years strong.
Very cool. And so do you primarily work with real estate agents, or are there other industries or verticals that you work with as well?
That's a great question. We work with everybody. So everyone needs someone to call their leads. If you're providing leads, you need to have someone that consistently can touch base with them. So whatever the industry is, as long as there is, if it's an industry that we're not necessarily familiar with, we will say, hey, you know what? Maybe you could provide us a script or some actionable, some best kept actionable items or things that we can say on the phone to convert these folks.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I mean, we're sticking to a lot of the same industries. We see a ton of marketers and a ton of different folks come to us to handle the lead calling because the marketers have great leads, but sometimes the end user doesn't have the tools or the ability or time to convert them.
Yeah. Got it. So, you know, I think a lot of business owners struggle with this from time to time. They're getting bogged down, whether it's with leads or other aspects of their business, they're wearing too many hats, and I think they have a desire. They deep down, they know that they may need to hire somebody, but they're afraid to pull that trigger. What, any tips on, you know, when's the right time to hire an inside salesperson?
It's a great question. So when it comes to hiring an inside sales rep, one of the things I always recommend, and of course, a lot of times too, it depends on the infrastructure of your business. If you're a sole practitioner and you're doing everything by yourself, and you find that you're missing, leads are falling through the cracks, you don't have the time to make the call, you don't have the time to engage with them, that is when is a really good time to look to hire an inside sales rep. And I always tell everyone that when you hire an inside sales rep, it is a marathon. It's not a sprint. Yeah. It is going to take time, because just like any business, and I mean, you know, Tim, you know, firsthand, yes, from being self-employed, just when you hire someone, they're not necessarily always going to get it day one. It's very rare that on day one, they're going to be perfect at it. So there is a little bit of an incubation period, and you've got to be in a place financially where you could say, hey, you know what? I can take this hit on my investment. I can give it the 60 days, the 90 days that it's going to take to really start to see my return on investment. And of course, as you know, there are certain areas in the business that have a really quick cash conversion cycle where, like, for example, solar's great. Yeah. We do a lot of calling with solar, and I mean, somebody will go and immediately sell a solar system and they've made their money.
Yeah.
Real estate, which is what we do a lot of, is a very slow cash conversion cycle. It might take months before that person sees their investment back. So you need to make sure that first and foremost, you have enough core capital sitting aside, you got enough money in the bank that you can justify that expense. And also, of course, have the patience and want to just regain your time, regain your freedom, because that's ultimately what we want to do, regain our time and freedom so that we can use the hard-earned money that we have to invest in some more fun stuff.
Yeah. So I think something real important to pull out of what you just said is they have to have realistic expectations, and they have to understand that this is an investment, which is really, really important. Otherwise, they're probably not going to be happy with the results in the short term, which I have this conversation all the time on the marketing side. It's the exact same thing. It's an investment. You've got to give it time to work. If you are expecting, yes, you may get some immediate results, but that's gravy. That's the icing on top of the cake. You've got to come in with realistic expectations. So once I make the decision, I decide to hire someone, whether it's hiring somebody who's going to actually be on staff or outsourcing to a company like Appointments Today, right? I'm making that decision one way or the other. What are some of the benefits that I can expect to see when I do that?
I'm going to add a question, if that's okay.
Absolutely, man.
You touched on something and I was like, light bulb. So here's what I tell everyone. A lot of times, one of the things that most folks will say is, well, I have these leads that are coming in every month, and I'm the best. I'm the best at converting the leads. I don't need someone else to call those leads. What I always tell people is to say, hey, you know what? I totally get it. But imagine this. If you've got, I would rather do one thing every day at a level 10, at the highest level, than do 2, 3, 4, 5 things at a level 3, 4, or 5. Because we all have that same amount of time in the day. So it's so vital that we find, okay, what is the highest and best use of my time? What is going to give me the largest return on investment of that time? And I should focus solely on that and then delegate the other elements of my business off. So when you said, though, the bringing in an inside person versus hiring an outside person, and what are the benefits? Well, first off, if you hire an inside person, you're limited to one person. Yes. And I don't know if I'm sure you've hired some folks.
Oh yeah,
we've all made that one hire that we're like, wow, what was I thinking? They were great at interviewing. They seemed like the best possible investment, and they were a nightmare. Yeah. So what I always tell everyone is the benefit of having a virtual inside or virtual inside sales company opposed to someone, you know, that's in house, we have an entire, we have a whole plethora of people every single day. I'm generally hiring someone. I hire at least a couple of people every single month, 3-4 people every month we're hiring. Okay. New. We have a really good retention rate, but the challenge is in the fact that sometimes certain people, they don't fit the mold, the core values, the just the alignment within your organization. And yeah, that's why it's so important to always have more people. Or maybe they get another job, they get burned out, whatever the case may be. We all know that calling leads is a 24/7, 365, grind it out, and you got to have the right mentality for it. So a benefit, though, of bringing on someone like ourselves that's virtual, if someone leaves, quits, whatever the case, they get fired, they get sick, they have their internet goes down, like happened to me beforehand. You have alternate people that can plug in and instantly make sure that your business doesn't stop. Yeah. Because let's just call it what it is. If you're getting 150 to 200 leads a month, how do you have time?
Yes.
Just as one, and then you're trying to do all that stuff. You don't have the time. So the benefit is simple. Grow your time.
Yeah.
Do it and focus on the areas that are going to give you the highest impact to the bottom line, because that's really what everyone's looking for.
Yeah. So it allows business owners to focus on areas of their business that are more appropriate for their, somebody told me a long time ago, you got to look at what your effective hourly rate is. You know, so as a business owner, if my effective hourly rate is whatever, maybe it's $500 an hour, maybe it's $2,000 an hour, $10,000 an hour, no matter what it is, if I'm doing an activity that I could hire out for $50 an hour or $20 an hour, I need to get myself out of that box as quickly as possible. So you're helping people get into and focus their time on where it's the highest and best use, and they're going to make the most amount of money. I also think if they're outsourcing it to a company like yours, like you said, they can scale up or down quicker. And my guess is most of your clients, how much are they spending a month to have you guys do it?
Yeah, it varies. I mean, so we have packages that start as low as $500 a month. And I mean, that, you know, generally speaking, that's going to cover about 3,000 touches. And when I tell people that, their jaw sometimes will hit they're like, 3,000? I don't have that many leads. It's not about that. A lot of folks,
it's the follow-up, right?
It's the follow-up. And it's also those 500 or 1,000 leads that are in your CRM that they're like, oh, those are old. They're old. They're a month old. They're 2 months old. Guess what? In most marketing areas, right then and there, they're in the buying cycle. They're still in that time where they're like, hey, you know what? I'm going to invest my money. I could buy something.
Yeah.
So the goal is to have someone who has the capacity to make those phone calls, to continuously follow up. But yeah, our pricing, I mean, it starts as low as 500. And I mean, that goes all the way up into the thousands, depending on how many leads they have and how many folks they want us to call.
Yeah.
Because we got clients that have a couple thousand leads they get every month. I mean, it really varies.
But the bottom line is, even if I'm spending $2,000, $3,000, $4,000 a month to have somebody like your company do it, how much does it cost to hire an inside salesperson? It's going to be at least $4,000 a month or more.
Yep.
You then have all the benefits, you know, all the overhead. I mean, that starts to add up really fast. So working with a company like Appointments Today, frankly, I mean, you can help them. That it helps bridge the gap between, gosh, do I need a full-time employee or not? And, you know, I'm assuming that at some point, some of your clients may just stay on. Others make it to the point where they're like, okay, we've got enough going. We need to have people in house, and maybe they graduate to that level. But this is a really easy way for people to start outsourcing that contact for not a lot of money.
It's true. And I'm so glad you said that too about bringing, because I always tell everyone, listen, if you can get someone in-house that's going to actually stay in-house.
Yeah.
Because that's the biggest challenge that everyone has is the retention. And then they don't necessarily have the tools for them to operate at the highest level, and they don't have the training. And when they do have the training, they give them, you know, they give them a script and say, okay, go ahead, have at it,
yeah,
read off this script. But there's so much that happens outside of that script. You could have the best script ever,
yes,
and there's still going to be something that's going to happen, that's going to take place, that's going to derail the process of the call. So there needs to be, when you're hiring us, you're not just hiring on a sales rep, you're hiring on a managing, you're hiring on basically a sales manager, you're hiring on a head of operations, you're heading, you're also hiring someone who has their own CRM, and also has their own dialing system, which, I mean, if you were to invest in all of that stuff, I mean, you're talking hundreds, you're talking over $100,000 before you even start seeing any money coming in.
Yes.
And most businesses don't have that kind of capital to invest in.
Yeah. I want to pull something out of what you just said, because I think it's really important to for people to remember, because we run into the same thing on the marketing side. You've got business owners, they're great at what they do, they understand their business. But, you know, managing certain people in different disciplines within their business is a challenge oftentimes, because if I'm not a good operations person and I'm trying to manage an operations person, I have no idea what the hell they're supposed to be doing.
So
same thing happens on the marketing side and the sales side. Great. So I can hire an inside salesperson, but if I don't really know what they should be doing, if I don't have the tips, the tricks to guide them and really coach them into doing a better job, I'm not really the best person to manage them. And so when they hire somebody like you, you know how to do it. They're alleviating that stress. And we see the same thing on the marketing side. They hire a marketing manager, but they don't know how to manage that person. Well, let somebody like us come in, manage that person, because we know exactly how to direct that person.
Yep.
And you can focus on what you need to do. So that's a really, really important point, because even if you hire somebody internally, you may not be getting everything that you could or should out of that person, mm-hmm, if you don't know how to manage them properly.
And it's so funny too that you said that and that you used that as your example, because I had, so Milton is his name. Milton is one of those guys, everyone loved him. He's very easygoing, but he's extremely intelligent. But he would always get put in the friend zone, where he'd be on the phone trying to sell someone, and they'd be like, "You're a nice guy. I don't want what you're giving me. But you can call me, you know, if you're ever bored, you want to just have a conversation," because they'd love him. He had a great personality, but he would get put in the friend zone. Well, he would come up with some crazy ideas. I'm like, this guy is really sharp. I don't know where he's getting these ideas from, but and they were like really good operational ideas.
Yeah.
I fired him from the sales side of it. And it was tough because I really liked him. He was great. But I'm like, look, this isn't for you on the sales side. I think you're amazing. I will gladly give you glowing reviews. I'll tell everyone how great you are. But I think sales is not necessarily your forte. Which we parted ways as friends. Everything was great. I hired him back about a year and a half, 2 years later as he actually filled in for the role of operations. And I'm like, okay, this is going to be a temporary fix. I'm going to have to find someone. He's been the best operations manager, including myself, because I was my own, you know, when I
started
the business, I did that. He has blown away everyone. I mean, and literally people in big companies try to, like, you know, they're like, please let me get on the phone with him. I'll pay you guys consultation fee to get on the phone with him, because he optimizes and does everything. I'm like, wow. So even myself, we all are guilty of, we try to do it all ourselves, and we don't necessarily know how to manage certain things that we don't know how to manage. Now we have an entire operational team built out because of him. And I mean, our company is stronger than it's been in years because of that. So it really is important to have the right people and know the business inside and out, and really know what success looks like and how to coach to it.
Right people in the right seats. Super important. So at this point, you kind of got me convinced. Like, if I'm making my first inside sales hire, I definitely think there is a lot of validity in looking at outsourcing it.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm going to start calling companies like Appointments Today, what am I looking for?
That's a great question.
What kind of questions do I want to ask?
I think the most important thing that everyone should look for when they hire an inside sales company is, number one, does the person on the other end of the line have a good indication and a good idea of what it is that you need to accomplish? And are you in alignment when it comes to that conversation? Are you in alignment with what that company specializes in? There are certain businesses, like, for example, I'm just throw it out here, like insurance. I generally stay away from insurance. It's one of those businesses where it doesn't necessarily align with my interests. A lot of my guys don't have the best, we'll do it, but it's not the best, one of the best time on those calls.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, you know what? Probably not going to be the best business fit, but real estate, mortgage, solar, Cairo. The list can go on, but you have to make sure that you're in alignment. You have to also make sure that there is experience that company has with your leads. And then, of course, I would also, the most important thing that I tell everyone when they're looking at companies, don't look for who is the least expensive, because look, there are companies out there, and I'm gonna put it out there. There are companies out there for $3 an hour. You can hire a virtual assistant.
Yes.
And then here's what I will tell you. Those guys are great for lower level task type of work. What do I mean by lower level task? Well, checking emails, making sure, I'll go a little higher than that, making sure the Zapier integrations from one system to the next is pushing things over, making sure that you have someone that can answer, you know, maybe there's something that comes in on a message board, they can answer it real quick, or just putting together some basic paperwork. Those are great positions for that. But you have to find someone who, if especially on the sales side, someone that has experience, someone that's well spoken, and someone that can actually share with you recordings and share with you testimonials and share with you all of the case studies that are needed so that you can make an educated and informed decision for your company.
Yeah.
Because that's the most important thing, and that's what they should be looking for as far as characteristics go. And then for yourself, business-wise, you got to make sure you have enough leads coming in. You got to make sure that you are patient and realize it's not a golden goose. I tell everyone that's not the golden goose of your business. It does take time. You have to have the patience. And you also have to be very, very much so willing to communicate.
Which should I ask about what their sales process is like? What's the, you know, for a business like mine, I give you a lead. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do?
Right. We need to have a standard operating procedure that's already built out. And we need to know going in, hey, this is what success looks like. I want X amount of appointments based on all these leads. And once the appointment's set, this is who you give it to. This is how you set it up. And we have to make sure that our process and your process are in complete alignment, or else it'll be a nightmare.
Yeah.
And that's for anyone, any business, whether you're hiring somebody in-house or virtual, you got to make sure that the processes and the procedures are in alignment with aligning to your goals.
Got it. I love it. So what, one final question before we end today, this has been super helpful information. Tell me a little bit about some of the people that may be listening to this or watching may not be at that point where they can make a hire. So they're doing some of this outreach. Do you have any tips for, you know, cold outreach, cold calling? How can we get better at this? For some of us, they'd rather bang their head against the wall than do this. So
true. So here's the thing. It's totally normal. And it's totally okay to get a little bit nervous before a sales call. I want to let everyone know that.
Yeah.
That is the number one thing. People get so afraid of rejection and failure that they just decide, I'm not going to bother with it. Or, I don't want to bother them. I don't want to be rude. So the number one thing, and we call it call reluctance. The easiest way to get over call reluctance is, first off, know your script. Know the ins and outs. And I mean, your script can be something as basic as written down on a notebook, have it on your computer, but internalize the script. Make the script your own. Don't sound scripted, because obviously people can tell if you sound robotic when you're on the phone.
Yes.
But I have a literally a framework. So when I talk to people, for example, business to business, the first thing I do is I'll ask someone, hey, you know, what is it? How, first off, how long have you been thinking about this? What is it that has made you decide to reach out to me today? Because it's very important. I put the onus back on them. I put that accountability back on them. And I put the ownership back on them. What made you decide to reach out today? Because it lands the subliminal suggestion. You decided to reach out. What was it that made you decide to reach out?
Yeah.
Once that happens, then I go through and I assign their mind to an agenda. And I'll say, okay, well, listen, just so you know, it's going to take about 30 minutes here. I'm going to go through all the ins and outs of your business, find out a little bit more about you and your goals. And of course, I'm going to ask you some basic questions. Please, all I ask, answer them as honestly as you can. And in return, if you want to ask me a question at any point, feel free to just jump right in. You can cut me off, ask me the question, and I will answer honestly for you as well. Does that sound fair? I've never had someone say, no, that's very unfair. Yeah. Never. Because all I'm doing is I'm planting the seed that I am going to now control the framework of this conversation.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk together, but I'm a reasonable guy. You jump in and tell me, hey, I need to ask this question at any point in time, and we'll go back and forth. I set their mind to that agenda. They're no longer nervous because there's nervousness. When you get on the phone with somebody, there's this awkwardness. You can't make the other person feel awkward. If they feel awkward about the fact that they're going to call with you,
yes,
it's over. So I want to make the, I want to put their mind at ease. Now, once I go through, I've basically opened everything up. I've assigned their mind to an agenda. Then I'm going through and I'm asking them the trigger points of what it is that's making them make a decision. I'm clarifying and I'm basically at that point, I'm closing, I'm asking for business. And then at that point, I'm helping them by moving them forward in the process. And when I say helping and moving forward in the process, give them all the information they need to make an informed decision. And lastly, I'm not afraid to tell somebody, hey, you know what? We may not be a good fit and that's okay. Yeah. I'd rather do that because I want them to work seamlessly with someone.
One of the things I love about what you just said, one is having kind of a framework, having an idea of what you're going to say. Right. It's really about being prepared, right? You have a script.
Yep.
You're going to kind of make it your own so it sounds natural. But being prepared is going to give people a lot more confidence to do the call.
So true.
The second thing you said that I think is really, really key here is, you're giving them the outline for the call, but then you asked for their permission. Is that going to be okay with you? I had somebody tell me that a long time ago, you know, permission-based selling, you know, where you're getting their permission, you're getting their buy-in. You know, on the marketing side, you might call it like a trial close, you know, marketing sales trial close, right? It's like, you're just getting people to say yes.
Yes.
Yes, that's okay. Yes. Right. Yes. Yep. So I really do like that. Do you also think, I mean, the more people do this and embrace it, the more comfortable they're going to get with it?
Yeah, 100%. And that was the other thing I was going to put in there too. Coaching, there's obviously always coaching that you can get for sales. And I mean, that's certainly a good way to go. But the other place as well, and I mean, this is a free tip right here. I mean, you could literally find a role play partner, someone in a similar business,
yes,
and role play it. Because the one thing that's always baffled me and blown my mind is, why are you practicing when you're presenting to someone? That's ridiculous.
Right.
You shouldn't be practicing while you're presenting. You should have a basic framework and a list of questions because it's very rare that I hear different objections. Most of the objections are usually the exact same.
Yes.
So you have that list, you know what to say when it comes up, and give yourself 2 to 3 responses for every single one of those objections. And really, I think the biggest thing is just asking the right questions up front. And if you ask the right questions up front and you isolate and identify their biggest challenges, you're going to be able to custom tailor your responses to handling those challenges. And if you can't handle them, don't take them on as a client. That's the worst thing you could do.
Yeah. So when you work with clients, do you have a set framework and then you tweak the framework based on their business?
Yeah, I mean, I would say, like, so we have a different framework for marketers. We have a different framework. We have a very similar framework for realtors and loan officers, solar, different framework. I mean, generally speaking, we even have different pricing packages for different businesses, because there are some businesses, like, for example, solar. I couldn't go to a solar person and say, hey, we're going to charge you X amount of money every month. I could, but most of the time it's performance based. It's based on how many appointments.
Gotcha.
And I offer that up for a lot of different clients, because one size doesn't always fit all. Yeah. And that's what I tell everyone. Sometimes one program may not be a good fit for them. So I think having different programs, having a different approach, but in general, I use a similar universal principle. Every time I talk to somebody, my goal is very simple. Number one, clarify what made them decide to reach out.
Okay.
Assign their mind to an agenda and let them know what to expect throughout the call. And then really, you know, take the time and dig deep, find out where their challenges are. And then, you know, of course, at that point, I'm pushing the pain. I'm telling him, you know, this is what your pain is. And then at the end, I'm closing and asking for the business. Again, only if we're in alignment. Only if it makes sense. Because there's plenty of times. I mean, I generally turn down more people than we take. And I do that because for me, it's so vital to make sure that we're in proper alignment with expectations, and that I can help you accomplish your goals.
Yeah. If they're not an ideal client, why work with them? Because you're not going to, they're either going to be difficult to work with, or you're not going to get great results. And that doesn't serve either of you. Right.
And we talked about it beforehand, where I was talking about, you know, hey, there are certain sources of leads that I'm able to have really in detail conversations. They got a credit card ready. They're the perfect ideal candidate. And then there's other ones that they don't have any leads. They don't even know what an inside salesperson is. And they're like, oh, yeah, I liked your page that you had. Then they don't have a budget for it. And right. They're the nicest people. And I push them in a direction of like, hey, this is what I would work on first before you look for, you know, inside sales.
Yeah.
And it's just, you got to make sure that whatever your product or service is, that you can deliver on it and provide something of the most value that's going to really help them. And if you're not helping them, there's not much you can do.
Yeah. Very good. Awesome. Well, Matt, I really appreciate it. You shared some awesome information that I know is going to help some folks. Where can people learn more about you if they are interested in learning more?
Yeah, just directly to my site. My name is mattmilia.com. And on there, you'll see we got a short video. Give you a little bit of information about what we do. And then you also go directly into my calendar. So you'll basically click a link, get right into my calendar, and we'll have a quick demo to really identify and see where you're at.
Cool. So if you're interested, reach out to Matt, please. It's Matt, M-A-T-T, and then Milia, M-I-L-I-A.com. If you need inside sales help, and you're just starting out, I would absolutely recommend reaching out to Matt. I know that they can do some good work for you. Thank you for tuning in. Again, I'm Tim Fitzpatrick with Rialto Marketing. If you want to gain clarity on where to focus your marketing efforts right now to get the best return, hop on over to our website at rialtomarketing.com. That's R-I-A-L-T-O marketing.com. Click on the Get a Free Consultation button. Guarantee you will get a ton of value from that call and walk away knowing exactly what your next steps should be. Thanks again for tuning in. Till next time, take care.